This is the Real Ass Podcast. Here's your host, Luis J. Gomez.
Yo, 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 what is up, motherfuckers? We're back. We're back. Are we pretending it's Friday morning? Guys, we are live here at Stand Up New York Comedy Club. Stand Up New York Club's right above Stand Up New York Comedy Club. The best comedy club. They're back in my good graces. Two spots this month. Two spots. I have 100% more spots than I had last month.
Wow.
They finally hired the extra security to have you.
Zac Amico, international superstar, is here.
Hey, buddy.
Chris Scopo's here.
What's up, bud?
And we have a very, very talented guest. We don't do a lot of guests here, but you're one of the guys that I've been wanting to get on the show for a little while. A hilarious comedian from Tuesdays with Stories, one of our sister shows here at Stand Up New York Labs. Mark Normand.
Hey, thank you. We just got done talking about you on our podcast.
Yeah, no. Oh, I know this.
Uh-huh.
Believe me, we not only do I know this, we played a clip of it last week on the show.
Oh, hey. All right. Nice plug.
Yeah, no. In reality, I just realized after listening back to it, I'm playing it to be like, yeah, fuck these guys. They shit on my best man speech that me and Zach worked very, very hard on this show.
You worked on that, Zach?
He punched it up.
Wow.
I know.
What happened?
I can't write delivery.
So this motherfucker, they shit on me. So then I was like, fuck this. I'm going to play on the show to show my fans what assholes they are.
Yeah.
The clip couldn't have been any funnier. Glowing review for Tuesdays with Stories. Psh, backfires in my face.
Wow. You should have played the best man speech.
Was it that bad?
Oh, my God. We were just
I tried
cringing.
To get it. I
you should have
get...
played a clip of their show as your best man speech.
Listen to me, okay? First of all, you motherfucker, it wasn't actually that bad.
I think you said you guys could never do what I do or what we do. This is about the industry.
I
kept saying the industry. You said Jesus Christ four times
first
in the first
of all,
10
you
seconds.
Fuckface, I have the best man speech. I
don't pull it up. We're having a good talk.
No, we're not.
I don't want to bring this down.
Did you write it word for word? He went by points.
He read right off the paper. It was brutal.
No, listen to me. Okay.
Dripping sweat. It looked like he was like trying to plead for his life in front of the grand jury.
I have the fucking speech. It's not that bad of a speech, okay?
It was all about comedy.
All right.
These two people had the best day of their life. It's a beautiful moment. They're getting married. These two short people. And you go on and on about the business.
I think that is a very relevant, part of mine and Gary's relationship. Also, you know this, and everyone knows this. If you do comedy, it is all consuming. Okay? First of all, Gary shouldn't even be getting married right now. He's out of his fucking mind. But the reality of it is the fact that he can share this life with this chick, and she has no dreams, and she's willing to do it with him.
This is all great. You see what I'm talking about?
Yeah. This is what we started with. Yeah. So please realize that what the final product was.
She's running this fucking dog walking business while Gary's living his dream. It takes a very specific type of person to
she's
do that.
She's the CEO of the dog walking business?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, he made her CEO. He didn't want to do it.
No.
Smart guy.
Very smart guy.
Aside from the marriage thing.
I started off, I said I want to thank Sherry and Richard, Matthew and Patricia. I used the first names of the parents, which was a tip that I got on a best man speech writing website.
Speech writing for dummies.
Was it really that bad, though? There was no redeeming qualities in the speech?
I mean, I kind of checked out at one point because it was so awkward.
How long was it?
It was at least 18 minutes.
No, it was not.
It felt like it, but I remember we're all just like, and then I remember looking over at Nate, who is filming you like an 8-year-old boy, so happy. Like, I'm glad I have this material recorded.
We're going to play the speech, and I guarantee listening back to it, you know, you record a podcast, you're like, oh, that kind of felt like a stinker, right?
Oh, yeah.
And then you listen back, you're like, oh, it was actually pretty good. I bet you listening back to that best man speech, it was pretty good.
I don't know.
I'm dying here.
Can we do like a...
It was tough because you had a lot of critics in that room.
That's true.
Up a little bit. They were going to harp
but
on you.
We weren't looking for big laughs. We weren't looking for punchlines. We just wanted it was something from the heart, something natural, and it felt so rigid and cold.
I'm rigid and cold. I have no heart.
All right.
Whatever. Fuck you, Mark.
I mean, I like you.
The point that the reason that I didn't even get upset. I wasn't really upset. Here's what I did. I fucked with them because they're just pussies. Okay. Here's the funny part. Okay.
Who's pussies? Yeah.
Mark and Joe.
Oh, okay.
Okay. They.
You got us good. I felt terrible. You didn't write back. I apologized via text and you didn't write back. And I was like, well, there it goes. I'm going to get hammer fisted on Tuesday.
Dude, I had Mark for 3 days just looking over his shoulder thinking that I'm going to like hit him or something. It was hilarious.
I wouldn't say that, but I just thought you didn't like me. I was like, oh, well, we're not friends anymore.
And Joe,
the color of the fists are lightning now, Mark.
What do you mean?
If I didn't text Joe, like I didn't text you back after you apologized, Joe wrote me a long diatribe of a text. And I had to write, hey, dude, no problem. Because I knew if I didn't write anything back, he wouldn't have went through with asking his girlfriend to marry him. He would have thrown him off for like a year.
Quit comedy.
It's a whole thing. Yeah. So, Mark, I am glad to have you, and we are still friends.
All right.
I thought you were kind of shitty to shit on my best man speech behind my back. You know, it's one
thing. I did it on a pod.
Yeah, yeah.
And to your face at the wedding.
That's the funny part, though.
They did say you're going to hear us, though.
That's what they do, okay? This is what I do. I do this all the time, okay? I say shit. I say stupid shit that gets me in trouble, right?
Yeah.
And then I go, wait, what are you talking about? I wasn't a secret. I wasn't hiding it. I was saying it on the podcast. It's a joke. It's a gag. But you're just hiding behind that. I know what happened.
That's a valid argument, I think.
Are you trying to be Lewis?
Yeah.
All right. Let's talk about some shit today, man. We came in. I thought there was nothing to talk about today.
Oh, we got a ton.
We got so much shit to talk about. Jim Carrey's girlfriend killed herself.
Woo-wee. All righty then.
Yeah.
She's so dumb and dumber too.
Do not go in there. There's a dead body.
Oh, man.
What the hell happened here? It's so funny. First of all, I'm surprised there's not more suicide in the comedy industry. We pretend that we're a depressed breed.
We got Robin Williams.
Was she a comedian, by the way?
No.
I think she's an actress. Is she anything?
I don't even know what she is. Her name is Kathriona White. Kathriona. That's a shitty name. I don't like that name. So law enforcement tells TMZ they responded to a call in the L.A. area on Monday night. They were told that they found the body of Kathriona White. Suicide note addressed to Jim Carrey, which references their breakup on September 24th. Kathriona tweeted
that's a rough one.
On the 24th, signing off Twitter, hope I have been a light to my nearest and dearest.
Wow. She saw Batman Forever. Had to wrap it up. Riddle me this.
Dude, that's pretty crazy, dude.
Yeah.
Now
he
here's the thing.
Jim Carrey, though. Like,
I blame him.
He is always on. That's tough.
It's like Mike Lawrence's girlfriend is eventually going to kill herself.
Oh, no doubt about it. Yeah.
Stop telling jokes. Be a human for once.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, dude, it's kind of crazy. Look, I don't look at suicide, and I've talked about this on the show before. I don't look at it as just this like crazy sad thing. It's like, you know, sometimes you want to tap out, you tap out.
Yeah,
you know,
I agree.
That's just life. But I mean, is it not proof that money will not buy you any sort of like happiness? Because that's the thing. I always think as soon as I make it in the industry, as soon as I make a certain amount of money, that I'm going to be like, fuck it, all right, all the depression will be gone, all of the bullshit and the anger. And I don't think any of that shit matters. It's more greed.
It's more you get, the more you want.
Yeah.
Yeah, also, they do studies on this. People who win the lottery are always depressed, wildly depressed.
A lot of them go bankrupt.
And that too, yeah. And because they just use that money to feed their hole in them, but it doesn't. You gotta earn shit. That's the only way you feel good about it.
Like rich kids always are.
Yes, they're always on drugs.
Always had money.
Yeah, exactly.
Law enforcement tells us they believe she died from an overdose of drugs. Pills were next to her body. We're told two friends found Kathriona last night when they went to check on her. Weird. Let me look up more information on this chick, Kathriona White. I want to see if she's hot. She has to be, right?
She's gotta be. Jim Carrey's
she's 30.
Lady.
Let's see. Here she is.
Jim Carrey?
Oh, yeah, dude. Yeah,
oh,
dude.
Man,
look at that bod.
Wow, she doesn't look bad either.
Carrie's got a good bod.
Plus, no autistic kids.
Dude, that's fucking... Look at her, dude. Look at that little ass right there.
Uh-huh.
Wow, dude. But you know what? Look at this picture right here. That's a batshit crazy girl.
Yeah,
you
definitely.
See it in the eyes.
That is those a batshit crazy girl. That... Dude, I'm going to tell you right now. You could just... There's a crazy type of chick, and that's the face right there.
Mm. She is pretty, though.
Yeah, very hot. Of course. That's the thing. You can't fuck around with crazy chicks.
Like, is Jim Carrey going to go into depression now? I mean, she basically killed herself because of him.
Yeah, I guess so.
Jeez.
How bad would you feel if your girlfriend killed herself?
Oh, God. Well, it depends on if you want it out. Yeah. But, Yeah, that would be awful.
Did she leave me half of next month's rent?
Right. Also, you get that my girlfriend killed herself.
Pussy.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah, you go to the club and they're like, Jim Carrey's here. He's probably mourning.
Oh, his girlfriend.
I'll blow him.
Yeah, but does that really matter? Is that when you're a celebrity at a high enough of a level, that's not going to matter.
I guess,
Jim Carrey can walk in to anywhere and just get any chick for the most part.
Yeah.
Like, look, it's not that every woman would just automatically fuck a celebrity, but I think that
a lot of them would.
You know, look, what are women?
Yeah,
women,
but the kind that go to nightclubs would.
Yeah,
in
exactly.
LA.
A lot of them.
Look, I think Jim Carrey's not a really attractive guy, but he's famous enough that I wouldn't fault any woman for just automatically fucking that
guy. Sure, of course.
Because women, that's what they want. That fucking dude, there's just something about being that famous. It's like the ultimate alpha male. I was talking to a chick about this last night. We were talking about it. It's like just being a hot chick, okay? Just being a smoking hot chick gives you like the same type of superpowers as Brad Pitt. You know what I'm saying? Like if you're just a 10, you could walk out, you could just fuck any guy you want at any, just sexually, I'm speaking.
But the guys, you can get the cream of the crop.
Yeah, 100%. Brad, but that is just, you could be a hot chick who works at Starbucks and you could just fuck any guy you want. That is like Brad, you have to be Brad fucking Pitt.
Yeah.
To be like, Mark, you're a dude who's been on TV. You can't just point at any chick.
No.
And fucking, you're talented, you've been on television, you're a good looking guy. You have all of this stuff to offer the world. And then you still can't just do what some hot 19-year-old barista can do.
Totally. It's so not fair, but guys, that's how the world is.
They're fucking, they have a superpower automatically.
Yeah.
You know? But Jim Carrey, I mean, he's famous enough that I think he could probably just go and get any chick. But when you're in this industry, I don't want to get all Gary Veter wedding speech here.
Uh-huh.
But I think we do end up gravitating toward psychopaths. You know,
it's kind of like what we were saying earlier. When you're born rich, these rich kids, they always kill themselves, they're on drugs. Maybe being super hot chick is the equivalent of being a rich kid. You know, you kind of go crazy. You
get everything your
you
whole
get
life.
Everything. So you don't have to work for
this
it.
This is the one thing she wanted, and she can't
she
get.
Got, right.
Can't get Jim Carrey. She's like, I don't know what to do.
Look, she's not that hot. She's hot. She's really hot, and
pretty.
I like her body.
She's
but
she,
here's the thing. She's hot like if one of us fucked her. We'd be like, oh, he's fucking that hot chick. She's not like fucking celebrity. Like, I think Jenny McCarthy is hotter than
right,
her.
Right, I agree.
You know, like Jenny McCarthy in her prime was the shit. Dude.
She should have killed herself.
Yeah.
But yeah, I totally agree. She's pretty.
I think it's kind of funny that, not funny, but I think it's kind of crazy that we end up gravitating toward these psychopath bitches. I've dated a lot of crazy bitches in my day. Have you dated crazy chicks, Mark?
No, but I've had a run in, and it's like, it's an eye opener.
What happened?
It's crazy.
You know, like you bang one, and then you're like, "All right, thanks." They're like, "Oh no, you're not just gonna fuck me. I'm in love with you." And she like wanted to meet my family, and she wouldn't stop calling. And she'd come to my house. It was brutal.
Yeah,
She would show up to shows.
Didn't she give you cookies or something?
She was
like
young,
that?
Right?
Brownies.
She was different. She was crazy, but she would bring me baked goods.
That's okay.
Stuff.
That's a good kind of crazy.
Yeah, and all
that's my fantasy woman.
There we go.
Yeah,
she
but
was
you
great.
You don't know what's in those cookies.
I ate them all. I didn't give a shit. No. Yeah, I was like, if she's in love with me, she's not going
to
kill me.
I used to fuck an 18-year-old girl back in the day, and I remember I was fucking her one time, and like they just let it slip out, dude. I'm fucking her, and she looks at me in the face. She goes, I love you.
Oh, yeah.
And then she caught herself, and she goes, I love you. The way you fuck me. And it was so like awkward, but I don't think women can separate that feeling.
Yeah.
You know, they really, I don't know, when women have sex with you, I think there's a genuine like emotion every time attached to it. You know, I get it though.
Oh, of course.
I want to snuggle. Every time I fuck, I want to snuggle.
Oh, not me. Yeah. I have that immediate, I got to get out of here feeling. But I fucked a girl recently, probably 6 months ago, and she was like, I know I'm pregnant. We didn't wear a condom. I'm pregnant. And I was like, shit. And so she was like planning our life out. She's like, all right, we'll move in together. We'll raise it. You'll be a comic. I'll stay at home.
How many times did you fuck her?
You know, probably like 10 times.
10 times. So you regularly fucking this chick.
Yeah, and I was like, she is probably pregnant.
Did you busted her?
No, I never did, but you know.
You did the move where you come on her post and then put the dick back in?
Yeah.
That's my favorite. That's my favorite move,
we
dude.
We call that the Amico.
Yeah.
And so I was like, shit, I'm sure she is. And so we were talking about an abortion. I gave her $300 and I was like, I'm giving you this money and I'm paying for the whole thing and I'll never see you again. And that's the deal.
Wow.
She was like, all right. And then she would still show up to shows.
Was she actually pregnant?
No, I don't think so.
So you think she just took your $300 and then spent it on two drink minimums at your shows?
I think so, yeah.
I had that happen too. I had my ex-girlfriend, who kind of looks like this chick, pretended to be pregnant for maybe 4 months after we broke up. And here's what's funny. Looking back, knowing about the pregnancy process now, and knowing like the first trimester, like when you find out the sex, I would just know now. You know what I'm saying? Because I remember she told me she was pregnant. It was like a few days afterwards, and she was being really dramatic. And she was like, I guess you're never gonna see your son. And she was like dropping the knowledge. But it's like, all right, bitch. You know, it takes 2 months to find out what the sex is, right?
Yeah, right.
You moron.
That's what my brother's girlfriend did. That every time they would have like a rough patch, she would just say, "I'm pregnant." And then the last thing before they broke up, he's on the phone with her. And she said, "I'm pregnant." He goes, "You're not fucking pregnant. Shut up." And then it was hilarious the way he just said it. Every time.
Yeah.
She would be like, "I'm pregnant."
Well, no, here, this is how I found out she really wasn't pregnant, because I didn't even know any better. I was kind of worried. I knew she wasn't, but I was terrifying. Kind of worried. I called her place, and her brother answered, and I was like, "Oh, is this chick there?" And he's like, "No, she's not here." And I was like, "Hey, dude, you know, to be honest, I was like, you know, she's telling me she's pregnant, and I'm just, ooh, you know, she won't talk to me now." And I laid it all out for him, because I was like, "Yeah, bro, none of my business. Don't know what you're talking about." And he hung up on me. I was like, that was weird. So then like a minute later, I get a call back right away. He was like, "Dude, she was in the room with me. She's not pregnant." Click.
That's whoa, all I get. Yeah. What a great guy.
Yeah, she's like a fucking psycho.
He's a bro.
And then she found out that he did that. She found out. And she had him arrested. He was a weed dealer. She had him set up, and the cops arrested him.
Whoa.
She had her brother arrested for telling me that shit.
She's evil.
She's a fuck. Like, to this day, dude. To this day, still, like, out there like a psycho, dude. Her sister ended up calling me, telling me that she was like, "Listen to me, you'll never, ever hear the end of this girl." She was like, to this day, she's keying her boyfriend's car from middle school.
Wow.
To this day. This is like, we were in our, you know, early 20s at this point.
You got out, man. You got out easy.
My brother's ex said they were pregnant. Had this, gonna break up, said she has cancer.
Yeah.
Said she had cervical cancer, and he believed her, because he called the mom. The mom's like, "Yeah, she has cancer." And
that's
then,
the worst. That's the worst feeling ever, when the girl gives a call. It's like, "Yeah, I think I'm getting pussy cancer." You're like, "Oh, dude."
And the mom just,
"My dick is radioactive."
That was on me.
Dude, my dick is glowing. So, if somebody's dick looks like a glow stick, don't put it inside of you.
Right.
Cancer just went away. Like, they talked about it for a little bit, and then it just stopped. It just went away.
Yeah.
She never talked about it again. Never was brought up.
That's
again.
Just the power of positive thinking. That's how you get it. That's how you get
that's
rid of cervical cancer.
Fucking crazy.
Maybe she was doing some sort of Tai Chi.
The secret. She read
the secret. Yeah, she read the secret. Yeah.
That's it. But Zach, you are the guy that has to have dated a bunch of crazy bitches. Because anybody who's going to date,
for them to fuck me in the beginning is a problem. It's like a diagnosis.
Yeah. I mean, have you ever had a chick threaten suicide? Yeah, obviously.
Yeah.
Have you ever had a chick kill herself?
I got.
What are you thinking about it?
Yeah, like, I know, right?
Like, did she die?
I got. Not because of me. I think I got. I got one suicide and two ODs.
Damn.
Jesus Christ.
Wow.
One suicide and
two ODs.
I got
one suicide and two ODs.
Yeah, but that's. It's very funny, right? You take a step back and you look at everyone at this table. You said, "All right, who at this table has had a girlfriend kill herself?"
Sure, it's the.
It's gonna be Zach,
the Juggalo's accountant.
The proof is in the pudding.
Holy shit, two ODs.
Yeah. Now, do they survive the ODs?
No, they're both dead.
Both? Ooh.
Ooh.
You got three in your
Not even though, like, look, if you survive an OD, that's just like an awesome experience.
Oh, no, I think I have two others that have survived ODs.
What the fuck do you do?
What are you doing on the
weekend?
Talk to me about this.
I like naps, and sometimes.
So do the three of them. Yeah. They're like permanent ones.
I had a problem for a while. I would be like, "Oh, this girl's great." And then, like, 3 months in, it was like, "This girl's on heroin."
Okay.
Oh.
And it just kept happening.
So they were all on the H.
That or pills, yeah.
Yeah. Well, how'd the girl kill herself? I want to know about this.
I have no idea. I don't. She was.
That's why she killed herself. You just didn't care.
She was. It was. It had been years before, and then just one of her friends told me she killed herself, and I checked
her Facebook.
Okay,
so it wasn't while she was with you.
No, no. It was a while. We were still talking, but I don't know what. We'd probably dropped off for like 2 months.
Ooh, it was that conversation that did it. Put her over the edge.
How'd you find out?
Facebook.
Oof. Oh, did you like it? Yikes,
that's crazy, dude.
And that was the hottest girl I ever fucked too.
Can you write her name down? I want to see a picture of her right now, because I want to see the hottest girl you've ever fucked. She's still like the fucking.
You want to write it in my phone?
Yeah, no, I'll write it down. Continue your
text it to me.
Write it in my phone.
Yeah, I've had tons of girls do the crazy. For me, the crazy girl thing, I banged a chick after a concert, And she stayed over, and I took her to Penn Station the next day. And I didn't know that the entire time we were walking, she was taking selfies. And this was like before selfies.
Oh,
and she took like 40 pictures of us and put them all online the next day with captions like, "Lovers, he's an asshole, but I love him. Together forever." Dude, my girlfriend was so pissed.
Yeah.
Wow.
Let me guess the concert. Philharmonic?
I'm looking for Kath Riona's tweets. Did they delete her account already?
Well, she deleted herself, didn't she?
Here's the thing,
right? Smart move.
If you commit suicide, right, can they go into your emails and Facebooks?
Yeah.
And
oh, like, yeah.
Your family can go into your email?
Totally.
Because, yeah, because they got to find out maybe it was a murder.
Exactly.
They don't fucking know who you were dealing with.
When you die, can they check email? I got to see this. What happens to my email account? There's no way, dude.
Man, in the 40s, you killed yourself. That was it. You were cool. Yeah. Now you can go back and read people's tweets about their dick and shit.
I did that one time. I met a chick. She was like, "Look, I didn't know if she was crazy or not." And I went to her place, but I wrote myself an email saying, "I'm going to this person's place. If I don't come back, she lives here."
Nice.
I didn't know.
Smart.
They never share your account information with anyone other than you. In terms of services, Yeah, dude. Oh yeah, I guess they will. They'll go into your account.
They gotta do it.
That's crazy though. What if you? But here's all right. Let's say you've been fucking around in your wife, right? You die in a car accident. Okay, they suspect foul play.
Ooh.
Now wife. She. Yeah. They have to. She has to deal with that shit now.
I don't know if the cops tell her that.
Pretty sure there's been a movie about that. No, they do.
They
I've
do.
I've seen movies about that. What was that movie with Harrison Ford? Or the
Star
racing,
Wars.
Racing Hearts or something like that.
Indiana Jones.
Racing Hearts, where he didn't know like his wife was cheating on him. With another man, they flew together on the same plane to another place to like fucking vacation.
Brutal. Well, no, there was
and
another
he
one
found out that,
that just came out. He found out she was cheating after she died. Another one just came. It was heartbreaking.
Hmm.
Dude, think about that, dude. You got your fucking wife. She dies. You're heartbroken. The mother of your kids.
Yeah.
And then you found out she's having an affair, dude.
Yeah.
That's got to ease the pain a little bit, though.
Well, no. now you wish she died a slower, more painful death.
Right. And you're at that funeral, like, "I'm sorry for your loss." You're like, "Fuck that piece of shit."
Worse if you get half the will, and the other half goes to the guy.
Oh, boy.
Dude. All right, did you send me her name?
I can't find her. I know her name, but she died before Facebook was big.
Oh, wow. 80s.
Oh, okay. Well, I wanted to see what she
And I looked up her live journal, and it was deleted.
And what happened? Now it's her dead journal. It's a different website. All right, so what happened with the girls that overdosed, though?
Heroin.
Were you
pills.
With them?
No, it was like, I've been a lot of girls' rock bottoms. Like, I've been the guy where I've had girls call me and be like, "We can't date anymore." Why? Because I'm going to rehab, or because I'm, you know, I can't live like this anymore.
That's fucking crazy, dude.
I've been a lot of rock bottoms.
Yeah.
Well,
but that was like younger me. That was like college me who was a maniac.
And your girlfriend now is not crazy.
My girlfriend's a regular person now.
Yeah, she's a nice chick.
This is like my first civilian, non-sex worker, non-drug addict.
I feel like
relationship.
If you're a rock bottom, though, you're going to get some crazy shit. Like, a girl's not going to hold back on her rock bottom, you know?
Well, that's how he gets her in the bed. He gives her a rock bottom. Yeah. People's elbow.
Oh, I see.
Next thing she wakes up, Zach's on top of you. It's not good. It's not good. Yeah, man. So Jim Carrey, now he's got to fucking deal with all of this shit. That's the selfish part. I do think it is a little selfish suicide. Just because you have the love, like, here's what she did, right? She's crazy. Okay, she's gonna kill herself. It is a lifetime of shit that she's been dealing with that got her to the point where she's gonna kill herself, right? Mm-hmm. And then she throws it all on Jim Carrey.
Terrible timing.
Yeah.
It's like when you move into an apartment and then the earthquake hits.
Yes.
It's like, fuck.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So it's like now he's gotta fucking deal with this guilt. He's got a. How old was she? Was she 24 years old?
Oh,
28 yeah. years old.
28.
Good for him.
Still young.
54 years old with a 28 year old. How great is that?
Hey, stardom.
Look at that, dude. Good
He's
for
also
him.
In that great age where, like, they're like, "I saw Fire Marshal Bill when I was 9, and I was in love with you then," you know?
Or who was that one chick that started dating Marilyn Manson? She showed up.
Oh, Evan Rachel Wood?
Yeah, dude. She showed up at his house on her 18th birthday,
and
she
was
"I want to
heard about
fuck
that.
You right now."
That's amazing. And they were. She was in the house for like 2 days.
Yeah. How cool is that, dude?
That's amazing.
And she's like fucking hot, dude. Just
yeah.
show.
Oh, wow.
Did they get married?
I might be a creep. Like, I obviously wouldn't date an 18-year-old girl.
But you fucked the shit out of 18.
I mean, come on. Are we pretending that 18-year-old girls aren't hot?
No, they're prime. They're literally prime.
There's this thing where you can't really say it. You gotta.
That's the Patrice bit.
You feel like a creep.
20.
Yeah.
20.
Is that how it went?
Yeah.
That was the count from Sesame Street. Yeah. You're thinking of 20.
Patrice the count. I don't know.
Yeah.
That is such
is a hot.
Fucking ripe age for a chick, and you can't admit to liking a teenage girl, even though it is an entire industry. Okay, the entire porn industry is based off of teen girls,
barely legal,
schoolgirl uniforms. There's all of these things that we got to pretend nobody ever admits that they find it hot.
Oh, they love it.
Yeah, but no, that's the problem though. Is like we have this weird thing where we can't just go like, oh yeah, that's fucking really hot. Just like women can't really go, oh yeah, Jim Carrey's a multi fucking millionaire right. with a Ferrari and he lives in a mansion. That's really really hot. Why do we have to ignore the most basic
truths? Oh, I love it when you come across a porn and you can just tell she's just turned 18.
Mm. That's great.
You're like, oh, this is gonna be so good.
It's right now. I search out porn stars based off of year they were born.
Oh, that's a good idea.
That's a good idea.
Yeah. Dude, my porn searches have gotten so
creepy.
Like involved.
You get so that deep rabbit hole now. You need somebody to be like, I'm adopted. You need something, you know.
Well, it'll usually start off with I'll go on a Shoosh Time or one of these, and then it'll trigger something, right?
Yes, yes.
So there's I've been searching lately guys auditioning for porn. So instead of the girl coming in and auditioning for the porn, it's the guy actually being auditioned by a female fucking casting couch agent.
I like that one. I've seen
phenomenal.
That. Really
I've never
great.
Seen that.
Because the woman takes control.
Yeah.
It's fun.
And there's two chicks.
Yeah.
You know, and he comes in and he's just like a fucking dude.
Plus, Lewis has a fantasy of getting an audition.
Or Fuck Team 5, where they
What's
just
that?
Take a normal.
Tremendous.
Take a normal dude. And like five just slutty porn star chicks just bring him into like a fucking woodshed and just fuck
what?
The shit out of him. Yeah,
yeah. And it's like hot, like Gianna Michaels, like top tier chicks.
I gotta check.
Hold on, I'll pull it up.
I'm writing this down.
I'll pull it up.
Fuck Team Five rolls. Have you seen Fuck a Fan?
Yeah, of course. Fuck a Fan is one of the best.
Hand job winner.
Here's the problem. Okay, this is what we need to do. Fuck a Fan. Yeah, dude. You basically you write an email for this thing. You win a chance to fuck this porn star.
Or they'll have like three dudes like have a competition like who can eat a plate of dog food the fastest.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And whoever wins gets like five porn stars to blow them.
There's another one where they call it it's like Battle Bang. And two MMA fighters fight, and then the winner fucks the girl in the cage.
Oh, I've seen that.
My head exploded the first time I saw this.
That's everything you love.
It's like,
oh, man, if you could have Dave Smith in there, that'd be all of Lewis's favorite things.
Look at this. This is Fuck Team 5. These whores.
Oh, my God.
It's just a normal dude. It's just some normal fucking dude.
Wow.
Look at this.
Oh, what's the catch? Like, how does he get to do it?
He's just, you're a dude. Look at this guy.
Oh, he's kind of soft.
Well, dude, think about that.
How would you not bust in 2 seconds?
I know.
Look at this. I mean, they're pretty. Well, first of all, how do you not bust in 2 seconds? Because you have a film crew there. There's five girls who have. They've fucking had so many huge cocks inside them. And then these girls are kind of mean.
Yeah.
Right? The Fuck Team 5 girls, if you're not getting hard, they'll all start making fun of your dick.
Oh, that's terrifying.
And then you're like, how am I supposed to get hard now?
Right.
Have you ever been in that situation with a girl where you're fucking a chick? And then you'll start getting soft a little bit. And then she'll be like, oh, you're getting soft. You'll be like, well, now
I'm fucked.
Now
it's over.
We need to stop. We need to start this whole fucking date over now.
We got to go back to Starbucks.
What are you doing? Just fucking tell me you love when my dick gets soft, and then it'll get hard.
There you go. That's a bit. That's funny. That's
Maybe.
A good point.
You know, it's...
I was with a girl recently. She was 24, smoking hot. I couldn't get it up because the whole night she was like, ugh, I dated this guy. He could never get it up. And it got in my head.
Yeah.
I couldn't stop thinking about it. And I was that guy.
It's all psychological.
Oh, especially if you're wearing a bag.
Oh, that's game over.
Zach,
you might as well just start over.
Only your girls make you wear a bag over your head. We have handsome faces. Yeah, well, condom. I mean, I don't even know. I don't even
tough.
Know if I could fucking use condoms in this day and age.
It's hard.
I would rather fuck, for 10 more years and die of AIDS than I think use condoms for the rest of my life.
Well, I can wear a condom if the girl's new. So I think I have like a 4 week, like maybe a month I can wear condoms. After that, oh boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd say maybe two or three times I could fuck her with a condom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, it should come off by then, you know? It's like a grace period.
I mean, well, it also depends. Like, you can...
Yeah, so we're not strangers anymore.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, we're all adults
if
here.
She's on the pill, if she's not on the pill, I'm using a condom.
I don't worry about that. I'm a pull-out champ. I'm more worried about
the
STDs.
I'm still worried about that, though.
You'll
be
fine.
Petrified.
But hold on. Here's the thing. Here's the thing that I don't understand, and it really is only in, like, poor communities. Having a baby is the worst thing that could happen to you.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
It is like it
coming
is
coming from the only father here.
Look, I'm not. I should let me rephrase this, okay? Because I, my son is my world. Okay?
Sure.
Worst thing is the wrong way to put it. If you, an unwanted baby is the worst thing that could happen to you. When I found out that my chick was pregnant, I wanted the baby. So it wasn't like, oh my God, this bad thing happened to me. But if you don't want a baby, okay, it is a fucking, dude, it's a lot, okay? And it changes, it is night and day. You have one life and then you walk it, you are a different person. There's no way to describe it. It's just you have to say, I'm willing to leave that other life behind and do this. How you react to having a child and how your instincts kick in, it's very unique to every person. But just understand, it is night and day a different life. So a chick to fuck you on a one-night stand or after fucking you a little bit to just literally just go, all right, now I'm willing to just have a baby and change my life is crazy to me.
I hear you.
And people who have babies really young, I think that is that is psychotic.
Yeah.
I think there's something wrong with somebody when they're 22 and they go, I want to have a kid now.
Well, it's usually a mistake. But yeah, the people who want a kid, they're either just have an empty life or they want someone to love them.
That's actually probably a good point too, is because you go, we have this career that we like, you know, you forget how big of a deal it is.
Empty life.
Until you don't. Well, you know, if before I was a comic, I was a kid though. I was really, really young. I've been doing comedy long enough. But it's like if my job was just getting up and going to an office.
Yeah.
And I get off at 5 or 6. I mean, ugh.
You get to have a team
now. You're done by 7.
Yeah. I just don't. I don't know. I mean, I guess having kids would be more interesting than anything else that I was doing.
Yeah. And plus, I've met girls in high school who were like, I just want a baby. I just want a fucking baby.
Yeah.
It's that primal thing. Like, some girls have it more than others.
A bunch of girls
like, I want a kid.
I went to college with, like, I just want to have a baby right after college.
It's yeah.
Like, why? Don't you want to live life a little bit?
They're like, that is life.
Yeah.
Chris D weirdly wanted to have a baby.
Who?
Chris D.
Yeah, yeah.
He told me, I mean, years ago.
Right.
He's like, yeah, I don't want to be a dad. And I'm like, what?
I know.
Chris,
some people are like
you
that.
Are just getting famous right now.
I know.
What are you doing? Why would you want a kid?
Chris is a weird guy, though. He likes to set up obstacles and, you know, defeat them.
Yeah. He's
that sounded weird.
Next season of American Ninja Warrior.
Yeah, exactly. Well, what's with the porn now? Every ad is just dicks. You want your dick bigger? Limp dick. Look at this dick.
Can you watch porn with a big dick? Like, do you watch big dick porn?
I do.
Oh, I like it.
Really?
I like it. Yeah. I like when the girl's small and a huge dick.
So you go black, or are you talking white guys?
I like white guys banging black chicks
with
a big dick. It's like reverse.
I like that too.
We're reversing it on them.
Yes.
We're bringing it back to us.
It's so because we really are just so spoiled now with what we have available to us.
It's insane.
That you can kind of like get that specific with what you search.
Yeah.
You know, it's such a weird thing because back in the day, you know, it was like you'd go to whatever the website. I'm trying to remember the website that I would first go to that it was just basically. I think it was.
It was called "My Brother Gave Me a Porn." That was it.
Well, obviously, but I'm even talking about when the internet came out because it was like
just downloading clips on like LimeWire.
Wasn't even clips.
Yeah,
dude.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even download clips because I had really slow internet speed. It was the dial-up shit.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd go to a website where you just click on the picture and the picture would load. After it would take six minutes for the picture to load. And honestly, you were so horny that really what you'd see the thumbnail and which you'd kind of be like, all right, I'm going to come to that one.
Yes,
and it would just take so long to load. You'd go make a sandwich.
Yes.
You'd come back and you just jerk off to that. And it's like.
I jerked off to the sandwich.
Even before that, you're right. I mean, when we were kids, I'd flip through the channels and I would just jerk off to every woman that would appear on the TV.
Sure, yeah. Baywatch was huge.
Yeah.
Ooh,
like it was
like
just a chick in a bikini. Home Shopping Network would be a beautiful woman showing off rings and shit.
Magazines? You jerk off the magazines?
Everything.
Yeah. Music videos.
Very carefully to rap videos.
Yes.
Very, very carefully.
Yeah, right. Like, ah, shit, it's Nas. Yeah. There goes my boner.
Mystical, get out of here.
Yeah. Missy Elliott, move.
So, and then now we have this thing where we have so much variety. We have so much available to us, but I think it's actually a good thing. I think we are almost turning a corner again where I've almost become desensitized to the amount of sex at my fingertips. So now I'm not watching porn. A few years ago, I was obsessed with porn.
Oh, yeah.
I would jerk off 3 or 4 times a day.
Me too.
All the time. I mean, just nonstop. When the internet first, like high-speed internet first was out.
Oh, that's all it was porn machine. This was just a porn machine. A laptop was a porn machine.
That was it. And whether it's you're getting more mature or you just have it available to you, it just stopped being.
Or that your son's in the room.
Right.
Nothing more uncomfortable than jerking off silently dry in the bathroom while you hear your son listening to Elmo in the other room.
Where's that Facebook video?
Now I'm picturing my dad doing that.
Yeah, dude. But it's like, yeah, we have so much. Like, yeah, dude, fuck team. I love that.
Yeah, and you start finding new fetishes that you're into that you would have never known about mm-hmm. in the 80s or whatever.
Squirt bukkake? I had no idea.
Squirts. I love a good squirt.
I had no idea that you could find a video of a guy in a swimming pool with 40 girls lining up to squirt on his face.
Oh, I've never seen that.
What?
That sounds awesome.
Squirt bukkake. I can't believe you haven't.
I like a good squirt video. It shows their. I like when girls have an orgasm.
Yes.
I'm old school.
And then the squirt is just evidence.
Yeah, that was the gayest thing I've ever heard in my life.
What? You like when a girl.
You need a girl to come in your porn?
Yeah, I like it.
Here, look. Here's Squirt Bukkake, dude. Look. I mean, this is just...
What a website is that? I got to go to this one.
XVideos is a great website,
dude.
XVideos is tremendous.
I'm on Lobster Tube.
Lobster Tube is great, but here's the problem with Lobster Tube.
I got a virus the other day.
No.
I did, yeah.
What, do you not have a Mac?
No.
Oof. Oh, that's your problem.
Grow up. So, yeah, look. These girls just fucking whack off on this guy's face. He sits there, and it's just, look, they're all just fucking whacking off.
Oh, my God.
And they just squirt all over his face. You gotta find the one that, like, they'll do like a slip and slide tarp, and it'll be in a backyard.
What?
Yeah, dude. Look. And they're really just pissing on his face.
They're really pissing on him, yeah.
They're just pissing on him, but that's okay.
It's only like 20% piss.
That, I have no problem with that right there.
I agree. I love a squirt. I had a girl squirt from anal, and it was the hottest moment of my life.
Wow.
She was a mom, Jewish mom.
Wow.
Yeah, banged her after the cellar. As a joke, we're on the sidewalk talking. She's fucked up, hammered, but she's like a hot mom. And I go, oh, what do we say? We just go back to my place, like as a joke. And she goes, all right, let's go. Yeah. I was like, all right. And it was terrifying. We get back to my place. She takes her leather pants off right away, and she goes, you better not have a small dick, which is like, you don't want to hear that. So now I'm just hoping I don't have a small dick. So I wrap it up. We start banging, and she goes, when are you going to put it in my ass?
Oh.
I don't know. Now? And so I put it in her, and she's on top.
Lube?
No lube.
She's got her asshole wet.
I guess. I'm using the...
She had tacos that week.
The veg lube and trying to cross it over.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't know, 10 pumps in, 3 huge gushes all over me, all over the bed. It was crazy.
What a pig.
And then she left.
Wow. She's
like, I got to get back to my kids. No, I never did.
That's okay, though.
I was in awe. Yeah.
That's okay. I
you got that memory, too, though. That's a good, jerk-off memory.
And it was a freezing cold night. I have, like, a drafty apartment, and half the bed was wet. So I remember sleeping on, like, the corner all bundled up, you know?
It froze over.
Yeah, exactly.
I had to throw out my mattress. It completely froze through.
I flipped it.
Yeah, first time I was with a squirter, I had no idea. I literally thought she was just pissing in my face. I had no idea. I was eating her out, and she just started pissing just right into my throat.
Wow. Just,
I didn't know what a squirter was. I was like 19. No idea. And I just was like, all right, dude, this is what this girl's into. I just was like, all right.
You took it.
I'm just fucking a girl that's pissing all over me.
I got a girl squirt in the back of my mom's car.
Nice.
That was a good one. Yeah.
What'd you tell mom? I spilled a smoothie?
I fucking cleaned it up. Before I went home, I stopped at like a Dunkin' Donuts and got napkins and cleaned it all up.
Yeah. Smart.
Yeah.
Didn't the car like stink like pussy, though?
I mean, I don't remember what it stunk like, but I just was like, I just got home late, and I was like, hey, Mom, going to bed.
Yeah,
and she never said anything the next day, so I was like, all right, cool.
Wow.
Yeah, dude, fucking in Mom's car used to be the best. My mom had a Dodge Neon. I used to fuck the hell out of girls.
What was your move? Back seat?
Back seat, knee. You know, there's that little, like, bump in the middle, right? Knee on that bump, one knee on the chair. That was my joke I'd say to the girl. I'd be like, look, my neon's on the neon.
Uh-huh.
As a fucker. It was awful. I was better at comedy back then.
Just try to bring that
you
one back.
You actually closed.
Yeah, dude. I mean, I used to be just a fucking...
My thing, because I didn't have a license, so my thing growing up was trying to get girls to jerk me off while they were driving.
Yeah.
Oh, that's fun. Stick shift.
Mm-hmm.
And while we drove around town, like in that like... dirty New Jersey, just driving in a circle, seeing what everybody else is doing, trying to get girls to jerk me off while they drove around.
When's the last time you got a handy? Last time a girl jerked you off?
To completion? It's been years.
Oh, completion.
But, you get one just on the way to the bedroom or something.
I got one. I got a hand job. I guess, yeah, dude, I remember this chick that I worked with back in the day. It wasn't that long. It was like 7 years ago. It was the last one. But, yeah, she gave me a handy to completion. We ended up fucking a bunch after that.
I'm not against a handy. A handy gets a bad rap.
Highly underrated.
Yeah.
Great release.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, like something cool about jizzing from someone else in a hand.
But dry, though, or wet?
Spit helps because the girls get a little trigger happy. They get a little tug happy.
The last one I remember was I was in a car, and I was fingering the girl, and she was jerking me off at the same time. So that was kind of hot.
Yeah.
But that's usually just foreplay. I don't mind a girl like jerking me off.
I came in my pants. It's just, I was like, I got to come. She's like, just go. And I was like, all right, cool.
Yeah. You know what's the best is when you go to a strip club and you jizz in your pants and you're like, all right, I that was basically a happy
ending. Actually done that?
I have, yeah.
You've come in your pants in a strip club?
I mean, I was, you know, 11, but
I never thought that was a real thing. I thought
it's
from a lap dance, the girl makes you come.
Lap dance, tits.
Yeah, you've never
seen
businessmen that keep, like, basketball shorts in their trunk and they change into it and they have a suit on top and basketball shorts and
that's
black
for
socks?
The feeling of the,
Yeah,
like yeah. I'm from New Orleans. These strip clubs were fucking dirty on Bourbon Street, and they used to have this thing. You could go when you're 18, and they would have a thing go, if you don't get a boner, you don't have to tip us. So they would bring out, like, it was my friend's birthday. They brought him on stage, sit on a chair, and all these girls, tits in the face, nibbling his ear, lap dancing, and then they feel for the boner, and if you get one, you got to tip them. Yeah. But if you don't, you're like, yeah, I won. Yeah. But then we're like, you're also a fag. So it's a fun moment.
Oh, shit. All right.
Can I bring it back to Handy's real quick?
Yeah, go ahead.
I had, before my trick now, I told you guys, remember the hooker that I used to say, the Colombian girl? You remember, did I tell that on this show?
I don't think so, no.
I met a girl who I had seen like years before, and I dated her friend, and her friend broke up with me, and it was like a real messy breakup. And the girl, I was talking to the girl about it. She's like, oh, yeah. She said you were a piece of shit. And I was like, oh, yeah, of course I am. So we're hanging out. And she's like, well, I didn't tell you. I haven't seen you in like 3 years. I'm an escort now.
Oh,
I'm like,
wow.
You're a hooker? She's like, no, I'm an escort. I'm on Backpage, like a whole deal.
Courtesan.
So, and she's like, actually, what happened was you paid me to look at my tits once. And that was the first sexual thing I ever did for money. And I was like, that sounds like me. So I asked her, well, how much, you know, to jerk me off? And she's like, oh, we've been hanging out for so long. We're friends. Just give me $20. And that was like a regular thing.
Wow. Yeah.
She would come over. She would bring her own booze, bring her own food. We would just hang out all night. And I would just give her $20 and she would jerk me off. And it was phenomenal.
Really? You never tried to move it forward? Like, you know, go
Why?
Next
it was
level?
Perfect. Yeah. $20.
I'd want to bang.
You'd have $100.
Yeah, I didn't have $100.
I would just try to
coax her. I was selling comedy tickets.
Yeah.
And he's not very good at it. Would you stop? If you, hey, sir, do you want to go to a comedy club? I would punch you in your face.
No, lesbian. Get away from me.
And it was phenomenal. And then because she was just bananas, she would call me at like 3 o'clock in the morning, and she'd be like, hey, I'm in your neighborhood.
Wow.
I'm with another dude. And she's like, do you want to spend $20? I was like, yes. I remember one time she called me. It was like super late. Just got back. I think I was working at Greenwich at the time. And she's like, hey, I'm with this guy. He's super drunk. The money's on the table, and he can't get up. He's too drunk. I'm going to steal the money and run to your apartment. I'm down the street from you. And I just remember this
girl you were dating was running.
I just remember this fat little Colombian girl in heels running up my block with $300 in her hand and me like, go, 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 go.
Wow. Man, oh, man.
And then she asked if she could stay over while I went to work. And she's like, just leave me your keys. And I was like, get the fuck out. I was like, you robbed someone last night, boy.
Yeah, you're not taking my Sega Genesis.
Dude, I used to fuck it. I mean, there's, I guess, a few girls throughout the years that I fucked where they were like, I'll fuck you, but you have to, like, give me a little bit of money, though.
Is that right? Yeah. Like cab fare kind of shit?
I mean, a girl blew me one time. I met her at the mall selling comedy club tickets in Queens. I used to live in by the Queens Center Mall.
Middle Village.
And yeah, Middle Village. And this is like the last couple of years I would sell comedy club tickets. I wouldn't even go out to the city anymore. I had guys in the city doing it for me.
Mm-hmm.
And I would just make like $100 in an hour. I'd just go down to the mall. And it was just so easy to like, I also owned the business. So I could literally give somebody 50 tickets for $20 if I wanted to.
Uh-huh.
You know, it just didn't really matter. Like I was very good at just kind of getting people to hand me a $20 bill. And I met this girl and I convinced her to come back and smoke weed at my place. That was always my line back in the day. I was like, let's go smoke weed.
That's a good move.
They were like, yeah. I was like, oh, but I don't smoke weed in the street. I'm not going to get arrested. So let's just go back to my place or get a hotel. I would always get hotel rooms, like hourly hotel rooms. And yeah, I went back to my room and we started hooking up. She was like, yeah, I'm not going to like fuck around with you anymore unless you want to like pay me. And I was like, what?
Oof.
I was like, you're a prostitute? She was like, no. She was like, I just need some money. So I was like, all right, well, how much for a blowjob? She's like, give me $50. I was like, okay.
$50.
That's good job. Prostitution.
Yeah. That is.
Yeah, basically.
That's solid. I had a girl blow me for half a bottle of Castillo once. The like $10 rum.
I think you won on that one. Good move.
And then she went to the bathroom and I chugged the rest of the bottle and left.
Jeez. True love.
I wanna switch gears here for a minute.
And then my friend Kyle got her pregnant. True story.
All right.
All right, Kyle.
I ended my other podcast yesterday. I did my final episode of the Hammer Fisting podcast, which is my mixed martial arts show. I was thinking about it for a little while, but in reality, I just got a lot going on, and you know, too many shows, too many hours spent weekly broadcasting and doing shows. So I had to kind of, I had to cut some stuff out, and you know, Hammer Fisting was the one, but I do still want to talk about MMA here and there, and you know, especially if it kind of relates to like a bigger story. So this, I'm on the train today, and in fucking AM New York, the cover of AM New York is a news story about UFC. The nation's biggest pro mixed martial arts league is suing New York to overturn the ban on mixed martial arts.
Yeah, what are they thinking with that ban?
It's one of two states, maybe three, that it's banned in.
It's the dumbest thing that they've
done. Well, it's some union thing. Like, there's, it has nothing to do with MMA. It's like some union thing.
Cooks or something like that?
There's a culinary union, which is the culinary union. I don't exactly know the way the unions work, but this is one of the really, really powerful ones. And all the culinary unions are all linked up. And long story short, the guys who own the UFC they own the Station Casinos, which is a brand of casinos that are not unionized, non-unionized casinos. So basically, these unions are trying to fuck over the Fertitta brothers by blocking the legalization of MMA in New York. It has nothing to do with the sport. It has nothing to do with danger for the fighters, nothing to do with people being exposed to it. It is just politics. It is just politics because the Fertittas won't unionize their casinos. So that's why we don't have it here. And the UFC, they booked out Madison Square Garden. This is the fucking power move. I read this yesterday, that they booked out Madison Square Garden. I was like, that's weird. They're not legal here yet. The reason they booked out the Garden is because they're going to plan an event, and if they block the event, if New York State blocks the event, they're going to sue the fuck out of New York for the amount of money and revenue lost, because they're basically saying it's just unconstitutional and that it has nothing to do with that.
Hmm.
So it's
a loophole.
Yeah, it's all a loophole, but I think it's really funny. Like, Ronda Rousey is the fucking, that's it, dude. It's so funny because they, and I'm reading this on the newspaper or on the train, and this black chick with her baby is across from me. She's like, oh, I love Ronda Rousey. She does those arm things. And I'm just like, God damn it, dude. It is like this,
she's
chick
huge.
Has, I mean, she's bigger than the sport.
Yeah.
Legitimately bigger than the sport.
Michael Jordan.
Yeah. And it's so funny because, like, in other sports,
except Michael Jordan made a good movie.
Did he?
Space Jam, baby.
Oh, come on.
You are a faggot. Dude,
is she the biggest star to come out of MMA?
I mean, I think
easily.
So. I think she's the biggest star made from MMA. Like, Brock Lesnar is debatably a bigger star. He's fucking huge. She's getting there. She's going to pass him.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I know Brock Lesnar sold more pay-per-views than her. I mean, he was somebody that people really wanted to watch fight.
He's a better fight.
But he wasn't made off of MMA. He was a star that came into the sport. You know, that's like CM Punk. He's going to fight in the UFC. He's already a star. He's going to be a big draw. People are going to be really excited to see him fight. But he wasn't made from this sport. She's like a homegrown fucking celebrity.
Do you know about her childhood?
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
About how fucked up her mom was?
Her mom was like a high level judo player. Like,
oh, is that right?
Taught by Judo Jean LaBelle, like one of the first Americans to ever medal in the
the
Olympics, but some sort of like Pan Am Games or something. But yeah, was her mother fucked up? I know her father killed himself.
Yeah, that, but I know her mom would like hide behind like the wall, and when you know, a young Rhonda would come in, she would just put her in a chokehold and be like, you have to get out of this. And like, she was like eight. And that was how she got so good.
Yeah, I mean, look, dude.
Yeah, and Beethoven had to play the piano every day.
Exactly.
Yeah, I mean, am I going to sit there and say that that's bad
no,
or crazy?
No, it was all funny. I mean, she wasn't.
Lewis's mom made him do crowd work every day before dinner.
Well, jeez, didn't pay off. But, yeah.
There's a video of a guy, he's a skateboarder, professional skateboarder, and he's got his kid, like, on the half pipe, the ramp. Actually, can you pull that up, Shelby? I'll pull it up for the
Tony Hawk?
No, just put a skateboarder kick sundown ramp.
That's fun.
Dude, he kicks his fucking son.
How old is his son?
Kicks.
28.
No, he's like a little fucking kid, dude. Look, there's a few right here. Look, dude. Video of a man kicking son down ramp. This
wow.
Is,
it's like when a dad throws his son in a lake. Like, learn how to swim.
Yeah, but like, I don't know, like, at what point, if this is going to be what they do have to, you have to let go of the bike eventually.
Sure.
You know? They happen to be doing a little bit more of an extreme type of sport. So it just looks a little bit worse than letting go of the bike and letting your kid fall and get a scrape and, you know, letting him know that his daddy's not there for him anymore.
Mm. Yeah, what if the kid becomes a legend in skateboarding and now it's
Jeez, start him on a smaller ramp. Look at the vert on that thing.
Go big or go home. That's okay. His mantra. Look at that.
Oh, that's tough. He just walks away from him, too.
I mean, he's got a helmet on.
Did this father go too far?
Oh, is that Chris Sen? I used to skateboard.
Oh, really?
Yeah, big time. Oh, no, that's not him. Never mind.
So, yeah, dude. Look, is that really abuse? The kid's got a helmet on. He fell the right way. It's not like he fucking... I can see if it's a drunk dad drinking a beer and then he kicked his son down a ramp and he wasn't even on a skateboard, you know? You know, look, everyone has their own way of parenting, and if your kid's being a
he's probably
a wuss,
helping him though, because the kid's gonna fall eventually. He's teaching them the proper way to fall.
Well, that's it.
Yeah.
You know, look, every time my son falls now, I pick him up and he starts crying and I kiss his boo boo and he wants me, like, he go owie owie and he comes over and he wants me to kiss it and it makes it feel better when I kiss it, but eventually, daddy's not gonna be there to kiss his owie anymore.
No, yeah. I hope not. You That'd know? Be weird if that got
mommy told him to leave.
Daddy was stabbed to death.
Yeah.
Because of an altercation outside of a comedy club.
But I remember as a kid, I got like in a scuffle with this other kid, and his dad came out, and he was like, go back and fight him. And I was terrified. You know, we were like 9.
Wait, his dad was the other kid's dad.
Yeah, and he was like, go, because, you know, we both like ran off like, you know, and covering our eye. And he was like, go back and fight him. This fight's not over. And I was like, hey, dad. Other guys, we're done. Like, get out of here.
You're the adult here.
Yeah, exactly. It felt really weird. And I remember he said to me, pointed at me, he goes, your ass is grass, which is like such a, like a 80s dad thing to say. And so we had to fight again.
Oh, you actually fought him again?
Yeah, but I mean, it was just like slap. We were kids, you know, we were like 9. So it wasn't like, you know,
by the way, if I saw you get into a fight now, I assume that you would also still slap.
I mean, I am taking boxing. But yeah, it was pretty ugly. Just seeing a dad like that, like, you, as a kid, you can't say no. So you're like, all right, an adult is yelling at us. We have to
that
do
is
it.
A look, my mom was that mom, and I've told this story. Uh-huh. My mom brought me around to fight all the kids that were picking on me.
Yeah.
But now, look, here's the deal, right? If it was me and a kid just got into a fight, which is sound like what it had, you didn't. I don't think you were a bully.
No.
You know, I'm assuming you got into a thing.
It was like we were playing basketball, something happened, we lost our temper.
Yeah, you guys got into a thing. I think that's kind of a fucked up move for the dad. Like, look, my mom, I'll give her a little bit of credit here. I was getting picked on, and I was having rocks thrown at me every day, and it was a group of 5 kids, and she was like, yeah, you can't come home crying every day. You got to go fucking fight these kids and let them know. Even if you lose, if you punch them in the face, they're not going to fuck with you anymore. That's it. They don't want to get – nobody wants to be punched in the face. It's just simple as that. Okay?
5, though. 5 is excessive.
Yeah, they were fucked up little white trash kids, and they were racist. And
Where'd you go in the day? 3-2, 4-1?
4-1.
That's a pretty good day.
4-1. Got my ass kicked by Nick Giacoli in front of my mom. It was embarrassing.
Yeah.
But – you know, I do think there was an important lesson to be learned there.
Yeah.
And I took away something really important, which is like, yeah, no, just punch somebody in the face. Just punch them in the face.
Right.
If they're, and not, I don't just go there. I don't punch people in the face. But if somebody were to fuck with me or my friends, typically that's an easier way to solve it than, you know, just fucking, hey, you know, don't hurt me. You know, it's just like, they're going to, typically they're going to walk away 9 out of 10 times. And usually adults aren't bullies. This is why, because eventually a bully gets punched in the face. All those kids were bullies and dicks when we were kids in high school. All of those kids. They're kind of cool now.
There's always some.
Hit me up on Facebook. They're I didn't really get bullied per se, but they were kind of shitty to me. And I hung out with a lot of nerdy kids. And all those guys were the popular jock kids in high school that were fucking just kind of assholes that said stupid shit, would make fun of other people. Eventually, they got punched in the face. Eventually, they had a kid who they didn't want to have bullied. Eventually, they met the person that made them want to be a better person. We all grow up, and you stop being that person, you know? I think it's an important lesson. With your thing, I think it's kind of a fucking shitty white trash dad to be like, well, now my kid's just going to fight because he had a disagreement with somebody. It's like, well, no, that's not... You shouldn't necessarily always punch somebody in the face because you disagree with something they said.
Yeah, and he was definitely one of those dads like, I don't want my son being a pussy.
Yeah.
Not on my watch.
It's a hard balance.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want my son being a pussy, but it's, you know, I don't know, man. I don't, my ego, we put so much of ourselves into our kids, and we use them as a reflection. We live vicariously through our kids. It's like.
But you guys also grew up right before you would have gotten charged with assault as a kid.
That's a thing.
Now we live in a society where, like, even I got into a fight in high school, and the kid's dad tried to charge me with assault.
Wow.
So, like, and I'm not that much younger than you guys, but we do live in a different society now where people are so sue happy. that you can't punch strangers in the face because they might fucking sue you and fuck your whole life up.
True. It is a weird thing. Like, people sue so quickly now. I was at a hotel last week in Reno, and the floor was like crazy slippery in the bathroom. I'm talking about like crazy. It felt like I stepped on ice. Mm-hmm. Okay. Like every time I knew it was coming, and every time I stepped on the floor, my leg would slip out and I would almost fall. Now, there's a metal, you know, the metal divider that separates like the bathroom from the carpeted room. It's basically a slab of metal that lies on the floor in the doorway.
Yeah, yeah.
In the doorway. It's just a piece of metal that kind of holds the carpet down and kind of separates the room. I don't know why they make that piece out of the sharpest piece of metal in the world,
right.
But it's just a fucking sword lying down on the floor, basically. So my foot slipped and went directly into it, dude. And I just lobbed off a little hunk of the bottom of my foot. And I was bleeding all over the place, dude. Bleeding all over the place. And I posted the picture on Instagram, and I had like 5 people hit me up, be like, "Dude, you gotta sue them. You gotta sue them."
Oh yeah.
And it's like, I guess I probably
That's different though. But that's an industry. I mean, you're suing a hotel.
You could have sued them.
Yeah, it's a hotel.
Well, and they would have settled out. It wouldn't have been anything crazy. But here's the reality: order to sue them, I would have had to give up the show at the Bunny Ranch that night. I would have had to probably cancel my flight because you have to show them that it's actually causing damages.
You gotta pay for a lawyer.
Yeah. But we were talking before about kind of how important we look at our job. And our career.
Yes.
It's like getting to LA was more important than maybe a frivolous lawsuit, maybe making $20,000 or whatever it was that I could have made off of some stupid fucking going to the emergency room and getting like 3 stitches, you know?
Right.
You know, going to that show in my mind was a bigger deal.
I'm with you.
Than that. And I think when you're a dude who's going to a day job, you go, "Oh, fuck that. I'll miss 2 weeks of work. This is great."
Right,
you know, I'll
just,
you know, I won't, I'd love to take off of work for 2 weeks and get a lawsuit and then maybe fucking take another 6 months off and spend a week in Bora Bora because, you know, it's like, that's all like, there's no part of that sounds appealing to me.
There's people that seek that out now, and that's like a society.
Of course.
When I worked at that haunted house, dude.
You can say it, Jews.
When I worked at that haunted house, every week, we would have cops come because somebody said someone attacked them or they fell. I worked a big haunted house. And I had a guy come into my room. He was like being an asshole and like trying to like act all wacky. And he fell. And he said, he hurt his leg. And somebody else in the haunted house goes to pick him up. And I went, "Don't fucking touch him. Everybody just leave him on the floor."
Yeah.
I was like, "Nobody that works here can touch this guy."
Yep.
And so we had paramedics come and pick him up. He said he hurt his leg. And his first words he said when cops came, he goes, "How am I supposed to make an income now?"
Ha.
Yep.
I was like, "Dude, I think you fell on purpose, bro."
Wow. Yeah, it's gross.
Those are the best videos. People fall on purpose in like hotels, and they just go down.
Yeah.
Have you seen those? Those are fucking hilarious.
Oh, where people are trying to fake lawsuits?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. They're hilarious.
Yeah, I don't get it, man. Me and my ex now, we sued our old landlord.
Oh, wow.
Because she we showed up at the apartment and it was under construction, and like it was just crazy. We ended up moving. We lost the deposit, lost security, lost everything. But she still hasn't paid us.
Jesus.
This small claims, it's $4,000. We still haven't gotten it, and she just won't answer the
emails. Bigger pain in the ass, probably for you though.
It's just not worth it.
It's not worth it.
The $4,000, I just want to disconnect.
They know that too. That she probably knows that. She's like, "Is he really going to come after me for $4,000? You got to get a lawyer."
Well, no, you don't. We went to court. We got the judgment in our favor.
Oh, and they still haven't paid?
And they still haven't paid us.
Shouldn't that be illegal?
Yeah, they get like a 10% added on, but they don't pay to us. We don't get anything extra.
Sure.
They get like 10% added on as a fine like every month that they don't pay it, but.
Wow, yeah. One time I was in shotgun. My friend was driving. We're going down the street in New Orleans. And they had a bunch of guys like sawing branches off a tree that was going into the street. Branch comes down, hits my arm that was hanging out of the window, and I was like, "Ah, you know, fucking huge branch." So when my friend pulled over, he's like, "You all right?" And every worker looked at me. They was in the tree with the buzzsaw, and I was like, "Ah," I was like shaking my arm out, and they all looked at me like, "He's going to sue us."
Yeah.
I got in the car, we left. That was it. I just had to shake it off. But anyone else would have sued.
For those 20 seconds, they were nervous as shit.
Oh, they were terrified, yeah.
Yeah, it's, you know, look.
It's a bunch of ex-cons, you know.
Yeah. I just, you know, how many times as a kid did you fall on some steps that were fucking broken or just some stupid shit, you know?
Yeah.
And it really never just came to my mind to sue somebody.
No, me neither.
You know, very weird. But I don't know. Maybe I should have just given up the fucking stupid show at the Bunny Ranch. And now
you had a good time.
Yeah. No, I didn't, Mark. You're crazy.
Oh, sorry. We watched two women go down on each other. That was it.
So let's look, Shelbo. We got some hate mail today.
Yeah.
Who's it for today?
It'll be Chris Scopo.
Chris Scopo.
Nice.
Some hate mail for Scopo. Oh, by the way, we're gonna do a new. Here's the thing. If you wanna give us some hate mail, because Shelby obviously is scouring Reddit and the internet, YouTube comments, everything we can to find the hate mail, and it's out there, believe me, it's not that hard to find. But if you would like to give us some criticism, if you'd like to be a part of the Real Ass Hate Mail segment, you guys can shoot us an email, realasshatemail@gmail.com.
Do you want to do that story, by the way?
Maybe. Let's see if we have time. Yeah, shoot us an email, and we will we'll read it on the show. Could be about Zach, could be about me, could be about a guest.
You know,
that's, we'll start doing that with the guests, too. We'll bring up some hate mail for the guests once in a while. But today, we are going to read some of Scopo's hate mail. That's what we do on the Real Ass Podcast. We embrace the criticism. We take it in, and then we try to grow from it.
Yeah. So, I heard you're off Reddit, too.
I'm off the Reddits.
Damn.
Can't do it anymore. Can't
too
do
painful.
It anymore. Not too painful. I'm obsessing over myself too much. It's Googling yourself times 100. You just keep on looking for shit about yourself. It's
and
just,
because he fed so many of those trolls, now they're like obsessed with him.
Yeah.
So there's just whole threads that are like, why did Lewis leave?
Yeah.
84 comments. It's like,
why is Lewis in a bad mood?
I can't do it. I can't. And it's like, I just need to run my shows the way that I run. My instincts are better than any 17-year-old kid that's giving me advice.
Right,
you know.
Right.
So I need to not obsess over what people are thinking and saying. Shelbo, let's do some hate mail for Chris.
You've got mail. You've got.
Why do you hate Luis J. Gomez?
You've got.
Why do you hate Luis J. Gomez?
You've got.
Tell me why do you hate?
Well,
that's a great word to use when describing him. He's very childish in the way he lives his life. Also, his views towards women are archaic. We didn't agree with their horrible viewpoints on women and sex in society.
Saying he's not a great father?
I mean, if I was going to flip a coin, I would say yes.
I let my haters be my motivators.
Hey, mail for Chris Scopo. Shelbo, what do we got?
Well, Scopo did a roast battle against Deepu recently, and the Reddit sphere had some comments about that.
Did they like it?
Yeah.
They did not like it.
They didn't like it, okay.
They were not crazy about it.
What did they say, Shelbo?
You were the best around 12, said, holy shit, Scopo's delivery and stage presence is horrific. How long has he been doing comedy again?
5 years.
And Steve Austin, 86, it wasn't the best battle, but they're still young comics. And I know Zac Amico wrote Scopo's best hit.
Oh, is that true?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I appreciate
these
the honesty.
These people have inside information, it would seem. These are just multiple Reddit profiles that I've created.
God, just when you think you're a loser, you hear all these people and you're like, oh, they have really no lives.
Oh, yeah, that's what I say. Holy if they're talking about me, my life is way better than theirs.
Yeah.
Way better than theirs.
And Almost Condor says, I can't believe this is the level Scopo's at. Jesus.
Well, that could be good, though. That might not necessarily be a bad comment, Shelby. Why do you have to look at the glasses being half empty?
It looked very empty, that comment.
Okay.
Oh, thank you, Shelby.
Boy, okay. Those lips. I'd really love to get in that mouth.
No.
Yeah, Shelby. Yeah.
Are you sure you're not black?
Last time I checked, no, but we could do a real ass DNA test. See, really get to the bottom of this.
Ancestry.com.
So that's it. That's all the hate mail for Scopo today.
That is for Scopo. Yeah.
That's it. Okay. That's not bad. That wasn't that bad today.
Not bad.
Scopes.
That wasn't bad. You're fine. Brush it off.
Yeah.
He literally just said everything that everybody already knew.
Yeah.
Right. And I said it as a judge at the battle.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's right. You did judge the battle.
It really was the worst thing that I was a part of recently.
Is that right?
Yeah.
You didn't do that bad at the battle.
You didn't do that bad.
I told you why I read off the paper because I have a stutter, and if I go over the words, if I read it right off the thing, I'm going to get every word right. If I don't, I'm going to go over some words.
Look, here's the thing. If you're just reading it, it does look bad. What you should do is you look at the phone. I don't mind people having the paper.
Yeah.
Look at the phone and then go and present the joke.
Well, I learned it from the first battle I did with Joe. I went over some words too quickly. And I mumbled some of the words, so I memorized them. And I memorized these, but I was like, if I just read them, I'll get them out properly.
Here's my problem with the judging that day, okay? Because I host the Roastmaster Show. You can see it every Tuesday night at the Stand Comedy Club. Guys, you can get free tickets at thestandnyc.com. I'll be there tonight. And I just realized, Zach, we have to write a bunch of roast jokes. Just remembered. Are you going to have time to help me today?
Yeah, I don't have work till 5.
Fuck me, dude.
Every
week this happens to me, dude. I forget that the Roastmaster is happening. I was like, oh, I need 12 jokes right now.
You really
now.
Are the worst. You're a good host, but yeah. you don't think about shit.
I don't.
Yeah, you really don't.
Which I, by the way, I did not use Zach yesterday. He bailed on me yesterday. Me and Rob Mayu wrote a bunch of great roast jokes for those fighters. You did not help me, Zach.
No, I did.
You left me cold. You left me cold there.
This is my burden in life. I'm fucking Luis J. Gomez's Bob Zamuda.
Yeah.
You're paying him, I assume.
No, not for this.
Oh, my God.
I'm paying him with exposure, friendship. He's made more money in comedy since knowing me than he probably will ever make. It's over.
Almost every paid gig I've ever had is because of him.
Yeah. All right.
He gets fucking paid, Norman.
Pay it forward.
So, yeah, we got to write some. I don't know. I'll figure it out. But what I did not like about the judging.
Please.
Was I feel like you guys unfairly called Scopo out for having writers. When in reality, most of the people that do the show have writers.
Sure, sure.
Most of the people do the show. There's like
the best
Lawrence, there's like Mike Lawrence, Mike Vecchione,
Sam Morril.
There's certain guys that make it like they're like, no, dude, I won't take any jokes from anybody. And I understand that as well. But at the same time, to call Scopo out for it when I won't even name names, but there's higher level comics that are also getting help. I feel like it just kind of makes it, of course. It makes Scopo look like more of an asshole than he has to be. When if you kind of pull the curtains aside on the whole thing, you go 90% of the people in LA and New York are all helping each other write for it. Lawrence told me that there hasn't been a single Roastmasters in New York that he hasn't written for multiple people for.
Right, right.
Like, people just come to him and ask him to write. And look, I think the show would be more fair if you had to write your own jokes.
Yeah.
But it also probably wouldn't be as good of a show.
True.
The one you called me out on was the one I wrote.
Oh, there
you
go.
I wrote that one. I wrote a few others, the LXII one.
Well, that's a good compliment.
Yeah, you were like, you didn't write that. I was like, I don't want to say it there, but I was like, I actually thought it like 2 hours before the roast.
But I felt, just felt kind of bad for Scopo because they were like, you know, fucking Bobby. It was Bobby, it was you, and it was Ari.
Yeah, and Ari's never written a roast joke in his life.
Yeah, Ari, that motherfucker is the first guy to talk shit. Right. He gets help from all the best writers in LA when he does these things. And that's, by the way, that's all fine. This is part of the show, and it's why the show is so good, because you get these high-quality jokes. It is also, there's something about putting together the set and just being able to deliver it and being in the moment. You know, it's more than just writing the jokes, but I felt like you guys were kind of unnecessarily unfair to Scopo.
Right, right.
When you get another guy who's got credits on, but he also did it. I feel like Scopo should almost have more the flexibility to have help writing the jokes because he's not a pro yet.
Right, right. And Ari was so mean on that thing that Bobby had to like shut him down at one point. Remember that?
What happened?
Bobby was like, Ari kept being like, you can't do this. Focus. This is all terrible. You all make me sick. I can't stand to watch this. And Bobby's like, hey, this is for fun, you weirdo, crazy Jew. Take it easy,
dude. I can't deny it. Ari was pretty funny in the judging.
No, he's a funny judge, dude, but because he's so brutal,
dude. They finished their first thing, and he was like, "Nobody won. Nobody won.
Yeah,
that was terrible. What the hell was that?
Right?
He's like, you're not even comics.
Yeah, he can't enjoy it. I'm just trying to crack wise, and he's like taking it seriously.
Oh, fuck me, dude. All right, real quick, because we got a little bit more time here. What do we got? Where are we at? We're about 120 right now? Yeah. We've got about 10 minutes left. Let's go to the Real Ask Questions segment for the day. Had lots of fans chiming in with some questions today. And you guys can all answer these questions if it's not specifically for me. It could be for all of us. So, Shelbo, let's get that music for the Real Ask Questions.
Give me a fucking answer! 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 Give me a fucking answer!
I'm asking you for the answer! It's a question!
All right, that wasn't too long at all.
Yeah. It's a little long shot, though. I'm going to cut that one down. If we weren't on video, I guess, like, for a radio show, because we could all take a piss during that intro. We could
all
regroup.
We could all leave the room and not talk to each other because we'd be doing a radio show together.
Yeah. Zach never stops. Randall Felton wants to know, when are you nutsacks going to do a Legion of Skanks stand-up tour?
Ooh. Well, Dave Smith can't work for money. It's in his contract.
I don't know. I don't think that's going to ever happen. I don't think so. Jay, you know, the reality.
You're three headliners now, aren't you?
Well, we all headline. I mean, obviously, Jay much more so than myself and Dave. but it's a weird conflict of interest. I mean, the podcast isn't big enough to warrant the amount of money that it would cost to bring all three of us onto a show.
Yeah, the tickets would have to be $100.
Yeah, it's just this, it's this weird thing. Like,
you have to do theaters.
Look, if it was me, Zach, and Dave on the show, it would be a different thing because we're, you know, none of us have this, like, road race. Jay can't go and do a Legion of Skanks show in Miami because his agent books him at a club to headline in Miami.
Right.
So it's this weird conflict of interest. So a tour is really hard unless the show gets huge for some reason, like huge, then we'd have the ability to do it. So yeah, tell your friends about it. Keep on pumping out the show. But look, dude, a real ass podcast tour, that could happen.
It's like when a fan goes, you got to come to England.
Yeah.
What, for you?
Yeah.
You get to fly me out there, one guy?
I would love to. It's just the business side of things, it just doesn't really work out right now. I've tried to set up a bunch of stuff with Jay and Legion of Skanks. Unfortunately, it doesn't work. But you can see all of us individually. Guys, buy the tickets for all of us to come. I'll be...
Sometimes you can see Lewis on Wednesday and wait till Jay's there on Friday.
There you go.
Bob Erickson wants to know, now that Hammer Fisting is done, any other good MMA podcasts? I listen to Fighter and the Kid, but that's more comedy than fighting. You know what, dude? I don't really listen to other people's shit. So, no. It's over, guys. You don't really need to listen to any other show except for Real Ass Podcast with Legion of Skanks.
Woo!
Ship is sinking. This is Mike Salona. Ship is sinking. And you can only save Scopo or Zach.
Ooh.
Who would you save?
Well, just the weight alone.
I got to go. I think I have a save Zach. I got a better chance in the water.
Well, if I threw Scopo...
I float.
If I threw Scopo off the boat would probably stop sinking. His ass is...
a buoy.
That makes
well, if you have to write the story of how you survived the boat sinking, you should probably keep me.
What are the benefits there? Zach's going to be funny. He's going to help me punch up everything I do.
Scopo's what, a punching bag? I mean,
he's got a car.
It's
a car. Okay.
Scopo will drive you home from the ocean.
He's got 22 minutes.
Ah, all right.
26 now.
Ooh. Tough one.
I'd have to save Zach. Zach, no offense, Scopes. I'm not hating on you.
I mean, I would save Zach, too.
Yeah.
Just the reality is I think Zach's bringing a little bit more to the table in terms of my life right now.
It's okay. It's fine.
Hey, all right.
I do more for you than you do for me. Me and Zach have a mutually beneficial relationship.
That's about 80-20.
Yeah.
All right. Kevin Vosberg wants to know... No, that's not even...
By the way, Zach is beaming right now. That's the nicest thing anyone's ever said to him.
Because Lewis has never said anything nice about me, ever.
That's not true.
I know, you fucking needy
bitch.
That's
not true. I say nice things about you nonstop.
Uh-huh.
The biggest fan, the biggest supporter of Zac Amico, it's Lewis J. Gomez.
No, you remind us every time.
Justin Sutton wants
to know... It was that girl, but she died.
If you were stuck on a deserted island with one book, one movie, and one song... What would they be? Everyone's answer would be entertaining. This would be the last question for the Real Question segment.
Oh, I hate these questions.
Mark, what would it be? You're on a deserted island. You got one book.
Yeah.
You got one movie.
Mm-hmm.
You got one song.
The book would be, or the movie would be Castaway, because maybe I get some fucking tips.
Nice.
The book would be, I don't know. Jeez, who gives a shit about a book?
Not a reader.
I'm going to go to the biggest book so I can burn it in the fire.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, give me the Bible.
Yeah.
Just to say, fuck you, God. And I'll wipe my ass with it. And then what was the other one? The best song?
The one song you'd hear.
Jesus Christ. Maybe Me So Horny by 2 Live Crew.
Very nice. Very nice. Zach, one book, one movie.
Oh, a porn song would actually be good, too.
Yeah, porno. Yeah, smart move.
Porno.
Book, I'm going... I got to choose either Party Monster, the story of the Club Kid murders in the 90s, because it's my favorite book, or Have a Nice Day by Mick Foley, because it makes me feel like a little kid again when I read it. Movie, Dead Alive, or Devil's Rejects. And song, I'm going to go... God damn, that's a hard one. Because you're going to get sick of it, right?
Well, you're going to get sick of all of it. That's why, by the way, that's why I wouldn't choose the porno. Because that porno is going to have about a week of use, right? And then you're like, fuck, dude, I kind of want to watch a movie.
Ah, interesting.
I got a good movie.
Maybe a long movie would be good.
I got Wild Things. because it's a little bit of porn and there's a movie in it.
Interesting.
You are a moron. It is like an awful porn and an awful movie.
Well, I think it's a good movie.
You stink.
You've seen that movie?
Have you ever heard Scopo's movie taste? It is
no.
So hilariously bad.
Uh-huh.
His favorite movie is National Treasure.
Oh, come on.
Not even joking.
There's a hidden treasure on the back of the Declaration of Independence. That is a fucking genius plot, and I'll stick to it. And they're coming out with a third one. Well, I'll go Wild Thing. So you can rub one out to Denise Richards.
Yeah.
And Neve Campbell making out in the pool.
Yeah.
And then you have a plot twist. And Bill Murray's in it.
You know, I think you have to pick. I'd have to pick something that I haven't seen.
Ooh.
That is considered like notoriously like great.
Have you seen The Godfather and all that?
I've seen all The Godfathers, but those are great movies.
Yeah.
Something long, something with
Would
a lot
pick,
of.
Would you pick like an Avengers? A lot of action?
No. It's got to have something with some depth.
Yeah, man. I mean, this is the only movie you're going to watch for the rest of the time, okay? Yeah.
Maybe Goodfellas, because it's just so watchable.
It's just so good, yeah. Or Casino.
Casino's a good one, yeah.
Or, you know, the one where he's in jail.
Freaky
Shawshank
Friday.
Redemption.
Oh, yeah.
Shawshank Redemption's always a great one. Feel good movie. The ups and downs in that movie.
Mm-hmm. A lot of good robot scenes in Shawshank,
yeah,
too.
A lot of gay rape.
Oh, yeah, song, yeah. I'm going Toto's Africa.
Solid song. Can we play that
just
for the end
like
of the show?
Damn,
can we just get a little Toto's Africa? That's a feel-good song.
Yeah, feels good.
I think what you need to do is...
But I think I would hold off, only listen to it once a day so I had something to look forward to.
You can call... I bet you can
In
call
the morning.
Me
you wake up every morning and you play that song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
because, dude, it's so weird because with music, it really depends what you're in the mood for, right?
Yeah.
Because what are you going to be doing on this island the most? You know? You're
eating just, a nice trying to get food. Starting fires.
Yeah. I mean, I would maybe think of some sort of like workout type. Maybe some Tool, like a really long Tool song, like an 11-minute metal song.
I would kill myself.
No, because
wait,
I have
Dave Matthews' 22-minute instrumental?
Yeah, but that's not going to get me pumped up, okay? That's going to make me fucking furious.
Uh-huh.
Like, you need a thing that's going to keep you going, and you need adrenaline.
Yeah.
You know, or a song that you're going to play in your deathbed after you get a spider bite after a week and you can't survive.
But imagine the ship, the rescue ship pulling up, and you're rocking out to Tool. They would turn right back around.
No, Tool's a great band. Tool. What's your problem?
I'm just saying. You're just I'm trying to get pumped up, dude.
Yeah, unless Big J's headlining on that boat, they're not going to stop for you.
I'm going to Cabo tomorrow, guys. That's why we're pre-recording this one, yeah.
Wow, what's the deal with Cabo?
Cabo Comedy Festival. I'll be there Wednesday to Sunday. So
that's fucking crazy.
You guys have $1,200 to fly out to Cabo. You guys can come and hang out.
I'm good.
I was a little bit nervous about it not being a cool gig. Because
it's Cabo, though.
I know, but here's the thing. Number one, I'm really broke right now. Everything I have goes towards my fucking stupid bills. I hate being at this level in comedy because I make enough money.
How much did you think he was going to say, my fucking stupid baby?
Yeah.
How much did you think that's what he was going to say?
I thought he was going to say stupid ex. That's what I thought he was going
to
say.
No. It doesn't go to my say. Look, here's the reality. This is where I'm at in my career. I'm at a place where I can just do comedy, where I don't have to have a day job.
Mm-hmm.
But everything that I make is already spent. I am house broke. I live in New York City. You know, well, look, I live in a pretty nice apartment. I don't live a bad life. You would with my ex, you'd think that we live in poverty, like in a cardboard box next to a shopping center somewhere, because she talks about it like we are fucking. But we live in a really nice apartment. We take vacations. I mean, literally, she just spent a week in California with the baby.
Oh wow!
You know, it's like we have nice stuff.
Yeah.
It's not really that bad. You have to look at like the positivity of it, but it's just so frustrating where you get a gig like this and I'm like, dude, I'm going to go to Cabo, but I just don't have the money to make it like a fucking awesome killer time and just do whatever I want.
Right.
Like I was up in Montreal with Che, you know, and he's just at a level, dude, where he's making money.
He's spending it.
Yeah, dude. We're in a group of 7-8 people and he's like, dude, shots for everybody. And it's
that's $300, you know?
You got it. Here's the thing. And I'm that guy. I'm the, I do shots for everybody. I just don't have the ability to pay for
right.
it. It's such a weird, I was talking to Big J and Dave about this. It's like when you go to comedy clubs, you know, Dave Attell, he drops a 20 every time he orders a coffee.
I know, it's crazy.
And it's amazing, you know, like it's, I want to be able to live my life that way. I'm just too fucking broke to do it. And all these waitresses at the comedy clubs, that is the biggest way to get into a comedy club. If you tip a lot, The wait staff fucking love you.
They talk.
You know what I do? Anytime I host the show, I'll make an announcement at the end of the show to tip the wait staff extra, and I'll talk about how hard they work. I was like, you know, tip them extra on top, and all the waitresses come up to me.
Is that your way of not paying them, but you have
no, no, I just can't give them a $20 tip for a coffee. I can only tip them $10.
Hey, and don't get any of them pregnant. Your life will be shitty.
Yeah, there you go.
But it's like, it's a weird thing, and it's like you want to be that fucking guy. And you want everyone to like you, but it's like, how do you get everyone to like you without being that guy first?
Yeah. You need the money.
It's crazy.
It's tough, but you're on the way.
I guess.
You got Amico.
Got the Amiks. He's there for me.
Yeah.
I'm going to make Zach pay for everyone's drinks that I order for them. But yeah, dude, but now I found out that all the food and all the drinks are comped.
Oh, my God.
Now it's turning into a cool gig.
That's incredible.
Now it's turning into a cool gig. And I saw the resort. I'm staying at like a really... Here, I'll show you a picture.
Who else is going? I've never heard of this thing. Who's going?
Monroe's going.
Uh-huh.
Gaines. Vladimir Camaño.
Oh, is this like an ethnic thing?
Apparently. There's a... You know what, dude? I just realized I don't know any white people that are going to this.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Al Jackson's going to be there.
Is this the Daily Show tour?
Here, dude, I'll show you the fucking I'll show you the resort, dude. So nice. I'm staying at the Villa del Palmar in Cabo.
I've heard of it.
Have you?
No.
Here, look at this, dude. This is just happening tomorrow. So now I'm getting excited about it,
this
guys.
This is huge.
Yeah, it's a big deal. This is it, dude.
Holy smokes. Who books this? I've never heard anything about it.
I don't know, dude. I got my new management.
That's great.
Yeah. It's fucking great.
Woo! Right on the water.
Yeah, pool, all that stuff.
Oh, man, you're going to get laid.
Lewis is going to be a fucking wreck.
Here's the thing, right? Weed in Mexico blows. I've been to Mexico before. Weed sucks. So I don't even think I'm going to buy weed.
Mm-hmm.
But you can go just to a pharmacy and buy anything you want.
That's pills.
Farmacia.
Yeah, farmacia.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think I'm going to just go and get a bunch of pills and kill myself.
When I went there, that's what we did. The first stop, we put our bags down and right to the pharmacy.
Yeah.
So you can get anything.
Oh, yeah.
You've been to Mexico before.
Many times.
And you've gone and...
We did all the drugs, yeah.
Wow.
You literally get anything.
So easy.
Yeah.
And is it cheap?
Cheap as fuck.
Cheap,
yeah. You get like 50 pills for like $12.
But hold on, why would I want that many pills?
You could probably sell a few, too.
I'm a Mexican drug dealer.
Well, he said you needed money.
You can stop bugging Scopo for Adderall.
Dude, this is fucking cool. All right, so I think that's what I'm going to end up doing. Because why buy shitty Mexican weed, you know?
Just don't be the guy. Don't let them know you're the pill guy at the show, you know, at the fest.
First of all, I'm not going to let anybody know that I'm on anything. I'm going to go at the end of the night and I'm going to take a pill and I'm going to get drunk.
Oh, there you go.
Act like I'm not even a fucking with anybody.
Right.
Here's the thing. Like, I'm friends with Monroe and Vlad and
Derek.
I don't want to lie and say I'm friends. I'm not friends with Derek. I mean, really? I'm friendly with all of them.
Yeah.
You know, but I'm really friendly with Monroe and Vlad. I've hung out with those guys a few times outside of comedy.
Good guys.
You know, I'm sure me and Derek will have fun too. But here's the thing that kind of sucks about it. You don't have like a legitimate like friend there. You know, if I had up in Montreal, I had fucking Soder there.
Right.
I'm sorry, Ari was there. It was so Soder and Nate. Ari and Nate were there. I just took a picture of one of those giant-headed people and called it Dan Soder.
Uh-huh.
But, you know, I actually had friends there to like hang out with and shoot the shit with. With this, I kind of feel like I'm going alone.
Yeah, that is a bummer. You got to get drunk. Yeah.
Well, just take half a Xanax before you drink, and you'll be friends with fucking everybody.
Yeah. No, but that's the thing.
Well, you know Monroe and Vlad, where you can call them up. Like, hey, guys, what are you doing?
Yeah, of course, but it's still not the same
type of... It's not the same. And also, Vlad's sober as a judge.
Oh, is he really?
Yeah.
Yeah, dude, here's the thing. I'm going to just... I've never done an on-my-own type of vacation. I'm going to treat it that way. I'm going to fucking...
Good for you.
I'm going to go to the beach every day.
See
I'm going to
write. A little bit.
I'm going to go out and do the touristy shit.
What do you want to do?
You're
in Mexico. You don't see the city.
Yeah, go in. Get a whore, you know.
Buy some chiclets from a child.
Yeah, get a weird taco made out of rubber or whatever.
All right. Listen, man, this was a good one, man. This was a fun one. Real Ass Podcast. You guys can follow us on Twitter, at Luis J. Gomez, at Mark Norm.
Mm-hmm.
Zach is not funny. Chris Scopo on the twits. Mark, anything coming up, buddy?
When's this come out?
Friday.
Oh, great. If you can make it, come Friday. I'm at the Draft House. Arlington Draft House.
I hear great things about that.
Nice. Great room.
I did that, yeah.
Great nice. Room. Yeah, it's fun. And then I'm at the Dead Crow Comedy Club, I think, on the 16th of October.
Very cool. Go check out Mark Norman. One of the funniest in the business. You always Always hilarious on everything you do, podcast, stand up, everything. Everything it is. That's the other thing. You know, you're a guy who, there's certain guys who just kind of had their own, you know, for lack of a better term, voice when I first met you. You weren't really doing anybody else.
Well, thanks. Jeez.
Well, Norm Macdonald a little bit, but
a little bit.
You weren't. There's nobody. You know, you come in, you see.
I wasn't a tell.
Right, you see Vecchione and Kurt, and everyone is just a tell. Everyone is a tell or Bill now.
Right. Yeah, Bill's a big one.
Yeah. But yeah, you're one of the original guys. Very unique.
Appreciate it.
Not, you know, a lot of guys should go watch do comedy for an hour. I would not recommend it. Mark is one of the guys that I would.
Ah, well, that means a lot.
You're great and very unique. Scopes, anything coming up, buddy?
Just the show I got with you, October 24th,
I believe. Yes, sir.
Poughkeepsie.
Check out Tuesdays. Sorry.
Slow month.
Slow
month coming up for me.
Is that a show? Slow month?
I mean, I'm doing a lot of spots around the city.
Yeah, I know you are, buddy. I know you are, pal.
Not road shows.
Zach, anything coming up, buddy?
Yeah, of course, I'm going to do that show on the 24th. You guys, and October 18th. Coming up, New York City Zombie Crawl. Get super, super drunk. We're actually going to go through a haunted house to the after party this year, and it's going to be some really good bands.
What's the date for the Zombie Crawl?
Sunday, October the 18th. And the after party is going to have some slamming hot burlesque tricks.
So you have to call? Do you have to, like, does it cost anything?
You just show up.
Can you do my makeup? Can I show up?
Yeah, of course.
Will you make me a zombie?
Oh,
yeah,
my
super
chick
fun.
Can do your makeup. My chick does makeup.
No, your chick does fucking, like...
No, he does makeup.
Sephora makeup.
No, she does fucking movies and TV shows.
Oh, she does zombie shit.
Yeah, she's all
okay,
that
I'll have your chick do it.
Yeah, but just you come hang out with us, drink all day. It's super fun. It's super cheap. Drink specials. Usually every bar is sponsored by a different booze, so you can get like dollar PBRs and stuff. Really fun. Come hang out October the 18th.
Love it. October the 18th. Go do that. I got some shit coming up, guys. October 24th, I will be in Poughkeepsie. I'm trying to fucking find the name of this venue. It's a brand new venue. I have it on my website, but right here. It's Eventful. Perfect. Got it. It's at Mahoney's Main Street. They have a name for the actual comedy club, too. Mahoney's on Main Street in Poughkeepsie. October 24th, 8:30 p.m. show. It's myself, Chris Scopo, Zac Amico also on the show. And Omar from the Legion of Skanks podcast. October 9th and 10th. That's just coming up in a couple weeks, guys. I'm going to be headlining out at Comedy Connection in Providence, Rhode Island. So get your tickets at comedyconnection.com. Follow me on Twitter, Facebook, all that other stuff, Instagram. Guys, Real S Podcast, happy to have you listening. We will check you next week. Peace.
That's all, folks.